Blessings to all of you. Sorry, I can't speak any louder. I'm going to do the very best that I can by God's grace. I'm going to give the message today. And as I begin, I want to invite those of you who are able, please kneel with me as we invite the Lord's presence. Gracious Father in heaven, I bless thee and thank thee for the privilege and opportunity we have to open thy word once again, to study those things that are for our admonition, that for our learning, and for our blessing. And I pray, Father, that thy Holy Spirit will give us wisdom and understanding, that thou will lead and guide us into all truth as thou hast promised. We bless thee and thank thee. And I pray, Father, that thou will be with my voice and be with my lips. May these words come from my lips and be heard in every ear, I pray, audibly and clearly. And I bless thee and thank thee and ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I have a glass here. Thank you, Pastor Allen. Well, it's been kind of given to my lot to cover the aspect of these prophecies that deal mainly with historical events. It's kind of a specialty of mine. History. I love history. Always have loved history. And today I want to share with you the history regarding the seven trumpets. The seven trumpets. And as we looked yesterday, we saw that the three great chains of prophecy in the book of Revelation, the third is the seven trumpets. And the seven trumpets we saw are God's judgment against what? And remember, do you have any students here? What is God's judgment against?
Mystery of iniquity.
The mystery of iniquity, yes. Thank you, Brother Dale.
My notes.
That's right. We'll be noticing the particular points in these verses, point by point. So it'll be kind of like a verse-by-verse exposition as we go along. It begins in the 8th chapter, and we're going to be covering two whole chapters and part of a third. So there's a lot of information, if you can imagine. And all this is history, so pray you'll bear with me. Revelation chapter 8 is where it all begins. The first verse, as we saw yesterday, ended the seventh seal. Today we begin on verse 2, which introduces the seven trumpets. We read verse 2. And I saw the seven angels which stood before God, and to them were given seven trumpets. And another angel came and stood at the altar, having a golden censer, and there was given unto him much incense, that he should offer it with the prayers of all saints upon the golden altar which was before the throne. Verse 4. And the smoke of the incense which came with the prayers of the saints ascended up before God out of the angel's hand. And the angel took the censer and filled it with fire of the altar and cast it into the earth. And there were voices and thunderings and lightnings and an earthquake. And the seven angels which had the seven trumpets prepared themselves to sound. Now these are introductory verses, but they establish the foundation upon which the seven trumpets are built. You'll notice here that we see an angel beginning in verse 3. Another angel comes. He stands before the altar. He has a golden censer. And what do we do with censers? Those of you who have ever been familiar with Catholicism understand what a censer is for?
Incense.
It's where you burn the incense. That's right. He takes incense and it's burnt upon this censer. Coals are taken from off the altar and incense is burnt. That incense is representative of the prayers of the saints. The saints are praying and those prayers ascend up to God. Did you catch that? Mm-hmm. What is the result? The angel, as a result of those prayers, takes fire from off that altar, puts it in the censer, and casts it into the earth. You have loud sounds, not just voices, but loud sounds, thunder and an earthquake, commotion in the earth. The earth is shaken as a result. God's people are praying. They're praying for something. And an answer comes from God. And the answer are seven trumpets, which spell out the judgment against apostasy in God's church. God's faithful people are praying to God, not only for deliverance. They're not praying for their own salvation, but they're praying for the purification of God's church. They're praying for deliverance from apostasy, deliverance from iniquity and sin. And the answer comes from God in these seven trumpets. These seven trumpets reveal not only the destruction of all earthly government, but the restoration of God's government. And you see it prefigured in Daniel chapter 2, the great image, the stone that smites the image in the feet, and in chapter 7 when the judgment sits and the kingdom is delivered to the saints. All this is again recapitulated in Revelation chapter 8, 9, and portion of 11. So here is the introduction. The prayer is answered, and the judgments are prepared. Now I want to summarize these in a brief outline. We're going to notice each one of them. The first trumpet, and we'll cover them in a bit more detail, but I want to give just a brief outline here. The first trumpet represents the fall of a portion of the Western Empire, of Rome, specifically of Illyria and Spain. The second trumpet represents the fall of Northern Africa, and I might include in that the destruction of the maritime trade of the Roman Empire, specifically in the West and also in the East. The third is the fall of Northern Gaul, or that portion of the northern portion of the Roman Empire in Europe. The fourth represents the fall of Italy and Rome. And so in the first four, let's back up there, the first four, we have the breaking up of the Roman, Western Roman Empire into 10 divisions. So this is the historical account of how the Roman Empire was broken into 10 parts. It's historically accounted here. God gives a detailed account of how it happened. So not only do you know that it did happen, God tells us how it happened and why it happened. The fifth begins the series of woes. Now the first four, we might call them woes, they're judgments. But the last three are specifically called woes. And they're not only woes to the Roman world, but to those to all who dwell upon the earth. And we'll see why as we proceed on. The fifth, the first woe, regards the rise of Islam. The sixth, the fall of Eastern Roman Empire, specifically of Constantinople, through Islam. And it also speaks of the political end, in a sense, of the Ottoman Empire. And the last and final ushers in the Advent movement and the people who will be prepared to meet Christ when he comes. It also brings to view the time of the judgment of God's wrath and the opening of God's temple in heaven, as we will see. So with all of this outlined, let's begin. Let's take up where we left off. Verse 7 introduces the first trumpet. Now, as I mentioned, I'm going to skip reading these for the sake of saving my voice, but we're going to notice them verse by verse. Now, I've given a time, the time period for the first trumpet. Now, these are, we might say, arbitrary times, but given the historical records, these are the most accurate times that I know of for the first trumpet, beginning at 395 AD and the close at 427 or thereabout, within a couple years. And here I have a picture of perhaps one of the most well-known instruments that was used to bring judgment to Western Rome. Verse 7 tells us that after the first angel sounded, there was hail, fire, mingled with what? Blood. And it was cast where? To the earth. Now, to those who aren't familiar with history, that's probably just going to be meaningless symbols. But if you're thinking of prophecy as it is history, you're going to be looking at a period of history and trying to find a period of history that fits with this symbol. Now, there's something in here that's very telling. Hail. Where does hail come from? It comes from the sky, yes. But generally, we see hail or snow, sleet or snow, in what type of, which part of the globe? Northern or the tropics? Northern, cold regions, right? You think of cold region. You have a judgment proceeding from a cold region. You have hail, a destructive element from a cold region, mingled with fire, which symbolizes destruction of land, and you have mingled with blood, the destruction of life. Here you have a picture that there's going to be destruction coming upon men, specifically the kingdom of Rome, come from the north, and it would destroy land and men. So that's, where do we see this in history is the question. We see it beginning in 395. Now, it began much earlier. It began around the 2nd century, around 160 AD, actually. It was when the people who were responsible for this trumpet first encroached upon the northern portion of the Roman Empire. There was a general migration that took place in the 2nd century of the Gothic and Germanic people. So here, I have noted here that the initial incursion began at 150 AD and ended at 376. The breakup began in 395. And the reason being is up until that point, the Roman world had been ruled by a strong ruler, a single ruler. His name was Theodosius. And he ruled from the Eastern Empire of Constantinople. He ruled from the seat of Constantinople. In 395, he died. And he left two sons who were weak and vacillating, who were kind of puppets of their counselors and of the eunuchs in the court. And because of their weakness, those who had served in the army under Theodosius, namely the Goths, began to be mistreated, mainly because of their religious faith. And if you were listening last night, you learned about the Arian Goths. You remember what the Arians believed? Anyone remember? They were non-Trinitarian and they were Sabbath keepers. These two things made them detestable to the Catholics. Worse than a barbarian, worse than an infidel, worse than anything in their imagination. They were heretics of the worst sort. And so, when Theodosius died, and Theodosius was a man that the Goths respected, they respected somebody who had authority and power, and Theodosius had that. And when his sons came into power, who were weak and vacillating, and they began to be persecuted as a result of this, they turned. And the result was rebellion. And it happened in the year 395, under a man named Alaric the Goth, a Visigoth. And the rebellion here is given us a place. It tells us what part of Rome would be afflicted. It tells us a third part of the trees and all the green grass were burnt up. And this is a location indicator. God is telling us where this plague would specifically affect. Though that would be covered in trees, grass. That portion of Western Europe that was mainly covered in plains and trees. And that's why I say this represents the fall of Illyria and Spain. I'm going to read a quote here, if it will jump there for me. A little slow. There we go. This is taken from a book called The Story of the Goths. And any of you are interested in the history of this people, this is an excellent book to read. It's one of the few books I know out there that really covers in any detail the history of this people. In page 66, he says this, after much anxious discussion, the prayer of the Visigoths was granted. And this is respecting their plea to the Roman emperor of entrance into the Roman Empire. This is around 376 AD. This prayer request was granted by the emperor at the time, Emperor Valens. Possibly the experiment might not have turned out so badly if the Goths, when they had been admitted into the empire, had been treated with generosity and confidence. But first to accept them as subjects, and then, after the death of Theodosius, to let them be goaded into rebellion by every sort of oppression and insult was a course that could only end in the most frightful calamity. And it did. It ended, really, essentially, in the breaking up of the Roman Empire. It was that first thrust that helped shatter the feet of that image. And it was because that of the religious faith. But not only were the Goths involved, and I just gave a list here, just are some of the other people that came with the Goths and were instrumental in breaking up that kingdom. And I want you to take careful note of them, because one of these tribes is going to be spoken of in the second trumpet. You'll notice that the Visigoths entered the Roman kingdom in 395 AD. They finally settled in what we know of as Spain in 427 AD. That's why I give the ending date there, 427. But there's a tribe that came in with them who were also Goths, but they went by a different name. And they are given to us in the second trumpet, which proceeds next. Verses 8 and 9 cover the seventh trumpet. Let's begin to look at those. Verse 8 tells us that when the seventh trumpet was blown, John sees a great mountain, as it were, burning with fire, cast where?
Into the sea.
So this is an indication of what? Fire represents destruction, you remember. This is a mountain, something massive, cast into the sea, and it's burning with fire. So you have destruction where?
In the sea.
Keep that in mind. So the events we're looking at under the second trumpet will be seen in the seas. Not on land, but in the seas. And the time is given between the years 429 and 533. And here is the name of that tribe that was responsible for it. They came, actually, they entered through the land of Spain before the Visigoths actually got there, came through Spain, crossed the Strait of Gibraltar into the southern portion of the Roman Empire and established a kingdom where once had been a great and mighty rival of Rome, a kingdom known as Carthage. And they established their kingdom in the seat that once was the capital of the kingdom of Carthage. And their king was Genseric. And they were the Vandals, also of Gothic origin. Now, sometimes when we think of Goths, and sometimes we have a misconception of Goth, we have Gothic things today. We think of dark hair, dark eyes, you know, this kind of deathly look. We have this morbid picture of Goths. But the Goths, another name for them, are Scandinavians. Germans. They're actually Aryan, is the name they use for themselves. Aryan race. Blue eyes, blonde hair. Those are the Goths. You think of the Swedes, the Norwegians, the Germans. These are the Goths. And I just wanted to clear that up, because sometimes when we think of Gothic people, we have this strange perception in our mind because of the way we think of Goths today. But this was broken up, this division of the Roman Empire was broken up in two phases. The first was the conquest of the southern portion of the Roman Empire, of northern Africa. That was completed between 429 and 455 by Genseric and his hosts. The second began after they had established themselves in Carthage, which is when he set himself on a new errand, which is given to us according to Gibbon. Let me note that here. He's given to us in this language. It says, the discovery and conquest of the black nations that might dwell beneath the torrid or hot zone could not tempt the rational ambition of Genseric. But he cast his eyes toward the, what's that word?
Sea.
He resolved to create a naval power, and his bold resolution was executed with steady and active perseverance. The woods of Mount Atlas in the western portion of North Africa afforded an inexhaustible nursery of timber. His new subjects were skilled in the arts of navigation and shipbuilding because they were the ancient Carthaginians. He animated his daring Vandals to embrace a mode of warfare which would render every maritime country, what kind of country?
Maritime.
Seagoing country, accessible to their arms. The Moors and Africans were allured by the hopes of plunder. And after an interval of 6 centuries, the fleets that issued from the port of Carthage again claimed the empire of the Mediterranean. And that's from the lips of Edward Gibbon. History tells us just exactly how it was fulfilled. The Vandals came to North Africa, but North Africa is kind of a barren land. There wasn't any way they could really support themselves financially, so they had to do it some way. And they were going to wreak vengeance on the Roman Empire. And his plan to do it was by sea, something that no Goth had ever done before. They were not known as seagoing people at this time. But he took the skills that the native Carthaginians had and put them to use, and the timber that the mountains of Atlas afforded them and put them to use in building a fleet that could contend with the mighty fleet of the Roman Empire. And the result was that in 2 decisive engagements, the whole naval power of Western and Eastern Rome was destroyed. Mm-hmm. Literally burned down. And thousands, tens of thousands of soldiers died in the sea. That's why the sea, it says in verse 8, became blood. Because of these naval engagements. And so as we have historically the course of the Vandals. They took not only the southern portion of Roman Empire, a third part of the Roman world, but they took also the maritime, trade. They controlled the seas. Rome was now landlocked. She was ready to die. And so we have this. This is taken from History of Rome by Philip Van Ness Myers. And there he tells us in preparing for what comes next. He says, the barbarians who were thus overrunning and parceling out the inheritance of the dying empire were now in turn pressed upon and terrified by a foe more hideous and dreadful in their eyes than they themselves were in the eyes of the Roman provincials. These were the Mongol Huns from the region northwest of China. So now, not only the Goths, who had been the instrument of God's judgment, these people were now themselves pressed upon by a foe even more frightening, if you could imagine that. You've heard tales of Vikings and how ferocious they were. Mm-hmm. Well, these weren't just Vikings. These Aryans were Christians, by the way. And if you read the histories, their conquests were not cruel to the sense where you find as the Mongol Huns or the pagan Germanic tribes and Gothic tribes, because there were some who entered into Rome that were pagan, and the cruelty that they wreaked was much, much worse. There's, in fact, a story of Alaric. When he sacked Rome, he gave a command to his soldiers that no one who was unarmed, man or woman, was to be harmed, that no church was to be damaged. Nothing was to be stolen out of them. And any man armed who sought refuge in the church would not be harmed. And all who sought refuge in the church would be spared. And so you see, in their vengeance, they were merciful. That was because they were tempered with Christianity. And a lot of people will speak about the the cruelty of the Gothic invaders, but in reality, they were much kinder than many of the other foes, many of the other wartime atrocities that we see in history. But we come to the third trumpet, and now a greater, more cruel foe now pressed itself upon the Roman Empire. And according to the language, it was short-lived. Have any here seen a falling star? Most of us, I'm sure, have. How long do they last? That's right. In verses 10 and 11, we read of a lamp, a burning lamp, falling to the earth, like a falling star. It's brilliant, but its life is short. And thus we have given us the history of the invasion of the Roman Empire under the Mongol Huns, specifically under this king, Attila, who was the most warlike of the Huns, and one of the most cruel of them, I might add as well. Now, Attila was not simply a heathen. He knew of God, but he believed himself to be the scourge of God. He believed he was called of God to destroy the Roman Empire. And the affliction that the Huns brought was something different than even the Gothic invaders. It's symbolized here as a burning lamp that falls from heaven. But more than that, the result of that burning lamp, and I have here the date, 451 to 453, very short in the scope of time. But the result of this warfare is likened unto wormwood. John says that the result of this lamp falling upon the seat of the rivers was that these waters were turned into wormwood. They were bitter. The result of this warfare had bitter results. And that's because the nature of the Huns themselves. If you understand the Mongol Huns, they weren't like we people in the West. We live in cities, in villages, in towns. But that's not the way of the Mongols or of the Huns. They were nomadic people. They lived in tents and they traveled about and lived off the land. And when the land was depleted, they moved. So when they took these cities in Europe, they destroyed them. They had no use for cities. So they utterly devastated them. They left the land totally destroyed. The villages gone. Everybody massacred that wasn't of a slavable age or use. Old were destroyed. Young were destroyed. And those that were capable to bear arms were forcibly brought in to take part in their military campaigns or enslaved as a part of their army. And so the result was bitter, very bitter. Cities were destroyed. And that prepared the way for the Gothic tribes that remained to come in, as we will see a little bit later. But it's called wormwood. And God says it was bitter for that very reason. Because normally when the Goths conquered a city, they would simply spoil it, take all its things of substance, and then they would leave it. But not so with the Huns. The Huns had no use for walls, no use for houses, no use for things like that. So they were destroyed. What crops could be harvested were harvested and gone. The land was stripped and burned. And so it was terrible, but it was short-lived, like a burning lamp. And the result, as you can see, men died because of these waters. Now, where did this burning lamp fall, by the way? It tells us a specific location. Verse 10, near the middle of the verse. It says, and it fell upon the third part of the what? The rivers and upon the fountains of waters. God is here indicating where this would take place. Where is the fountains of waters for Europe? Where do the waters, the rivers, have their source?
Mountains.
in Europe. The Alps, yes. And it tells us that the Huns, if you follow the history of the Huns and their invasion, they followed the rivers. Because the Huns were a cavalry, mainly. They had to have massive amounts of water to supply their horses. So they followed the rivers in their invasion. Just as the prophecy specifies that the burning lamp would fall upon the source of the rivers. They followed the rivers that came from the Alps into Europe. And the only way the Huns were turned back, they were completely successful in every engagement until they met the combined forces of the Romans and the Visigoths. When these two forces united, they met Attila the Hun near, I believe it was Tours in France, in an engagement that was terrible. The slaughter was probably over 100,000 died in one day. I mean, it was terrible. And it cost both sides deeply, but it cost the Huns more. And the result was that the Huns pulled back in 453. They pulled back to in the area that we know now as Bulgaria. And there they resided until Attila set upon a new course, and this time he invaded Italy. And he was negotiating terms with the Roman emperor. And his terms were that he would spare Italy, he would spare Rome, if the emperor's daughter was given him as a wife. And the emperor refused. And Attila was preparing for the destruction of Italy. But he died in 453. And when he died, there was no one strong enough to lead the Huns, and the Huns just dissipated. They fled back and eventually settled in the country where we know of today as Bulgaria. But their entrance, the utter devastation of the land, the laying waste of the cities, prepared the way. The weakening of the Roman Empire and of the Goths prepared the way for these other tribes to sweep down and take the land that was ripe for it. And so we see, beginning the fourth plague, these tribes, once Attila was gone, those that he had enslaved were set free. And these tribes sought land for themselves within the Roman Empire that was now essentially open and free for the taking. And among them were the Heruli, or Herulus, the Ostrogoths, and the Lombardi. Three tribes that would play a crucial role in the history of Rome. But now we come to the fourth trumpet. And in the fourth trumpet, we see the utter destruction of Rome. Now, Spain and Illyria had fallen. North Africa had fallen. Now, all northern Gaul had fallen as a result of Attila's invasion. What was left? Italy. That's the only thing left to Rome. That was all that was left to Rome, was Italy and Rome itself. So verses 12 to 13 tells of the destruction of Rome. And it tells us in the language of the sun, moon, and stars. How many here are familiar with the use of sun, moon, and stars in prophecy? What they represent? I see a show of hands. I see a few hands. What does the sun represent as a symbol? Remember yesterday we learned from Isaac Newton that the heavenly things, the things of heavens, represent earthly things of politics. Remember that?
Yep.
So the sun represents who? If the sun is the king of the heavens, what would he represent on earth? If he rules the day, then what would it represent in political affairs? A king or an emperor, right? The sun rules the night. He's a lesser light. In Rome, who was beneath the emperor?
The Senate.
The Senate, yes, thank you.
Yes.
The stars were lesser lights than the moon. Who did they represent? Who was third in the Roman Empire? Any Roman historians know this fact? They were known as the consuls. It was the highest rank that any citizen could rise to. was a consul, could be elected to, that is. It was the highest elected official, save for the Senate themselves. The Senate was only reserved for those of noble families, whereas one of any common folk could rise to the rank of a consul, who was in the third in rank in the empire. So these three would be smitten, and the light of these three would be darkened for a third of the empire, which tells us that the last portion of the Roman Empire in the West would be extinguished. And that was Rome. And this happened in the year 476 AD, under another Gothic tribe known as the Heruli, and their king. I have here a picture of Theodoric the Goth, who supplanted the Heruli at about, 493 AD. The son was smitten in 476. The emperor relinquished his throne to the Herulean king in 476. But yet the moon and stars remained. Those were not darkened until the year 541, even after the Ostrogoths disappeared. So the period of this fourth trumpet is between 476 and 541. It was in the year 541 the complete power of Rome was extinguished for a time. And so by the year 400, at the year 400, the Roman Empire looks something kind of like this. You have the Roman world there in the kind of lavender color. You have the Gothic Germanic hordes in the north, in what is now modern Germany, Denmark, and these regions. They came down from Sweden and Norway into these regions. And this is what the Roman world looked like right about 400 AD. But by the time we come to 500, the Roman world looked like this. Now all that's left of the Roman world is where?
East.
To the east. So where should we turn our eyes? To the east. And so we read of the historian in George W. Botford's History of Rome. He says, we should never lose sight of the fact, and this is an important fact to those of you who are interested in history. We should never lose sight of the fact that the German nations, or Gothic nations, were free to work out their destiny of the continent only because the empire, that is the Eastern Empire, formed their bulwark against the powers of Asia. They were a protection. The Roman Empire in the East was a buffer zone against the powers of Asia that were rising. Who were those powers? We'll see. Such it continued to be for hundreds of years longer till Constantinople fell. To whom? To the hands of the Turks. So the Eastern Roman Empire preserved Europe and allowed it to develop and strengthen so that it could meet this next woe. And that is a fact that should never be forgotten. And we might curse the Roman Empire. We might curse them. But they are the reason why we are here today. If Europe had not been sufficiently strengthened during that time and had the Eastern Empire as that buffer zone to protect them against the Islamic hordes that were raging in the East, we would not be here today. We would be Muslims. Don't ever forget that. And so we turn to the fifth trumpet. Now, these next two trumpets cover the whole of chapter 9. We're going to do some point by point. And I want to go through it as quickly as I can. The fifth trumpet begins in the year 609, shortly after the fall of the Western Roman Empire. The year 609 saw the rise of a man who was represented in prophecy as a star fallen from heaven. Now, what does a star represent in prophecy? Anyone tell me?
Power.
Power? How about Revelation 1:20? What does it tell us about angels there? Or stars? I just gave it away.
Angels.
Yes. Stars are angels, messengers. A messenger, is a prophet a messenger? Yes. Here we have a messenger that is fallen. What kind of a messenger? A fallen messenger. A false messenger. A false prophet. It tells us of the career of a false prophet, that it would be like a falling star. Short. Like Attila the Hun. His career began in 609 when he began to preach his doctrine. And it ended in his death in 632. To him was given the key of the bottomless pit. Now the bottomless pit, in order just to spare you all the historical details, the bottomless pit refers to that southern portion, the torrid portion of the Middle East, Saudi Arabia, the hot region. That's the bottomless pit. It's a desolate region, and that's why it's called the bottomless pit. Abyssos in the Greek means desolate. And so it's talking about that desolate region, that portion of Saudi Arabia. And to him was given the key to Saudi Arabia. And what was that key? History tells us that shortly before the rise of Muhammad, a war took place between the two greatest powers then in existence. The Eastern Roman Empire and the Empire of Persia, or the Sassanids. These two powers fought for about 20-some years, a little over a quarter of a century. The result was that they were both terribly weakened. Neither really gained any foothold, but the result was that both were weakened. Both were essentially, their legs were cut off. And this gave a key to Muhammad. It was his time. And thus we are told in verse 2 that he opens the bottomless pit. It was during those years of the war that Muhammad was preaching his gospel and consolidating the tribes of Arabia for their work, for the spreading of the gospel of Islam. That gospel was what we know as the religion of the Quran. And here's just kind of a, and this religion is related and symbolized as smoke. What does smoke do to you? Kind of makes you choke, makes your eyes sting, makes you cough. That's how this religion is pictured. It's smoke. When he opens this bottomless pit and he consolidates the tribes of Arabia, the result is smoke is seen arising from this region. And something arises out of that smoke. But here is just kind of a map that shows how quickly the empire sprang up. The green portion represents that which Muhammad consolidated during his life. So he controlled essentially all of Saudi Arabia before his death. When he died in 632, he left it to the second in command, who was a duly elected caliph at that time. We'll notice him in a moment. Through him and the three succeeding caliphs that followed him, the purple portion was conquered. You notice all of the Persian Empire and a good portion of the Eastern Roman Empire within a very short period of time. The lighter portion, kind of a tan portion, it's kind of hard to see there, was a result of the Umayyad Caliphate, which followed them. So by the year 750 AD, all the extent of the Roman Empire, and even more in land mass than it involved the whole of the Roman Empire, was conquered by Islamic hordes, even into Spain by 750 AD. And they were stopped there by Charles Martel in the year 732. So we come to the next verse, verse 3. Locusts arise out of this pit as a result of it being opened in the smoke. Locusts come out of the smoke. The locusts are representative of the hordes of the Arabians that came out in jihad. They were inspired into a holy war. And their leader was Abu Bakr. He was the second to follow Muhammad. And through him was initiated that holy war for the next 100+ years that conquered all of the Persian Empire and most of the Roman Empire and part of Europe from 632 to 732. You have it in three phases: expansion and conquest during the year 632 to 750, Then you had a period of about 300 years where the empire was in internal conflict. There was an internal struggle from 750 to 1096. And the third phase is that of the Crusades. When Western Europe was sufficiently strengthened, it came against its threat in the East in the Crusades from 1096 to 1272. And in verse 4, we have the command given to them. And if you want to understand more about this command, I would invite you to read Gibbon's Decline and Fall of the Roman Empire. It's found in chapter 51. There he gives in detail this command by Abu Bakr to his hordes before they issued forth on their holy war. But we're not going to go into that today. Next is verse 5. Verse 5 enters a new portion, a new history. That history, what we just covered, from 632 to 1272 had passed. In verse 5, we learn about a period of time that the Roman Empire would be tormented. It would not be killed, but it would be tormented for 5 prophetic months. And how long is 5 prophetic months? 150 years, yes. So for 150 years, the Roman Empire would be tormented. When did this happen? History tells us that it was at the rise when the Islamic world gained its first king. That king was named Othman. He was the angel, as spoken of the bottomless pit, whose name was Abaddon in Hebrew and Apollyon in the Greek, which literally signifies he who will destroy. He was the one, not necessarily him specifically, but his kingdom, that of the Ottoman Turks, would be the one to destroy Constantinople and bring the Eastern Empire to its end. And beginning of this portion was a period of 5 months that the Roman Empire would be tormented. It would not be killed, but it would be tormented. And it began in the year 1299 when Othman came to the throne, July 27th, 1299. And it ended the same day in 1449. Verse 6 tells us that in those days men shall seek death, but shall not find it. And history tells us, this is an interesting fact, that history tells us that those who were in Constantinople, and Constantinople at this time was all that was left to Eastern Rome, they preferred the rule of the Islamic people over the rule of their own emperor. They detested their own emperor, and they preferred the rule of the Islamic hordes. But to go outside the walls of Constantinople was death. Very few were allowed to flee after this period. Men sought death, that is, political death. They sought the demise of Constantinople, but they couldn't find it during those years. Verses 7 through 8 tells us the appearance of these locusts. An apt description of the Turks. Now, I want to hear you familiar with Turks. Turks are not Arabs. Don't get that mistaken. Turks are not Arabs. They're part of the Eastern Asiatic people, similar to Tartars. And they had a custom very similar to Sikhs or Sheikhs in the East. That is, they wore turbans and their hair was long. They had the Oriental custom of wearing long hair. If you've ever seen Chinese and the like, these people, they wore their hair long. They had hair like women, but don't be confused. They weren't effeminate. They had teeth like lions. They were fierce and cruel. So don't let their long hair fool you. They were something to be feared. Verse 9 tells us the sound of their wings was something that struck fear into the hearts of people. If you had lived in the days of King David and King Saul and you had heard the iron chariot to the Philistines, you would have known what that fear meant. Because their sound of their wings, the sound of their cavalry was like that of the chariots, horses leading chariots of war. So it inspired fear. Verse 10 tells us, again, recapitulating, the time period that they would hurt men. Verse 11, their king, as I mentioned, he who will destroy. And this brings us to the sixth trumpet. Verses 13 to 21, completing chapter 9. Begins in the year 1449, the end of the 5 months of torment. In 1449, a sultan, not a caliph, but a sultan came to the throne, a king in his own right. His name was Mehmed, or Mohammed II. He was a Turk. In verses 13 to 14, it tells us that through him, the four angels, who represented the four governing provinces of the Islamic world in Aleppo, Iconium, Damascus, and Baghdad, would be combined. Through them would be prepared the destruction of Constantinople. They were prepared for an hour, a day, a month, and a year. How long is that in prophetic time? Well, I've given you the answer. You add it up, it equals 391 years and 15 days. Why so specific? Why down to the very day? God doesn't want any infidel to be without excuse. God tells things down to the very day. When God speaks it, it happens. And not only does it happens exactly when he says it will happen. And God, when he speaks, he wants people to tremble. To know that his word will not return unto him void. It will be accomplished. That torment began July 27th, 1299. It ended July 27th, 1449. 391 years and 15 days from July 27th, 1449 takes you to when?
August 11th, 1844.
What happened on that day? The power that had destroyed Constantinople politically came to an end for a time. Because it's now rising again. It would be to slay the third part of men. The last of the Roman Empire would fall under the sixth trumpet. The fall of Byzantium, as it was then called, or Constantinople. Verse 16 tells us the number of the horsemen that would be involved in this destruction. Now, I don't know if that comprises the army that actually destroyed Constantinople or the whole number of the host throughout the years. Because it's around 200 million. A lot of men would be involved in this. Verse 17 tells us their description. And there's something in the description that is important. Because in the description it talks about these horses, and out of their mouth proceeds what?
Fire,
smoke, and brimstone. Now what do fire, smoke, and brimstone have in common? They have one thing in common, firearms, black powder. When you mix saltpeter and brimstone, you get gunpowder, black powder, among other things. And the result of firing black powder, not the gunpowder we have today, but black powder, which was used then, is you have this huge plume of smoke that issues out with a gout of flame. And it's yellowish in color. You have smoke, fire, and brimstone issuing out of the mouths of horses. And here you have a picture of cavalry not armed with spears and lances, but with firearms. And it was due to this that the men die, as we see. By these three, the smoke, the fire, and the brimstone, were the men to be killed. Constantinople had resisted every foe that had come against it. Its walls were as large and as thick as those of Babylon. It was impenetrable. It had the sea on two sides to protect it. You could only come at it from one side. And it had resisted every foe that had come against it until the artillery of Mehmed II. He commissioned, and if you want to read more about it, read Gibbon's Decline and Fall, chapter 68. it describes that artillery that he had commissioned from one who defected from the Greek Empire. And the result of all this, the world was onlooking at the destruction of what had been the world's most prominent and powerful empire. They saw it destroyed. The pride of the Roman world was humbled. God was giving evidence of his judgment against apostasy to the world. But what did the world do? It says they repented not of their what? Of their idolatry, of their murders, of their sorceries, their pharmakeia, and of their thefts. They repented not. Even though they saw the judgment of God, their hearts were not changed. Had their hearts been changed, there would be no seventh trumpet. But because men's hearts are unrepentant, like ours today, there is the seventh trumpet. And that takes us to chapter 11. Now, as we saw, chapter 7 was kind of a parenthetical chapter between the sixth seal and the seventh seal. So you have chapter 10 is parenthetical to the sixth trumpet and the seventh trumpet. It goes between them. And it gives us information, filling out details, what happens between these two. Chapter 11, verses 14 to 19. Before the seventh trumpet sounds, in verse 14, it tells us that the third woe comes what? Quickly. So there would be a short space between the end of the sixth and the beginning of the seventh. Did you catch that? Mm-hmm. When did the sixth end? August 11th, 1840. The seventh trumpet began when? 1844. A short space. Verses 15 to 17. I want to read these with you. The seventh angel sounded. There were great voices in heaven saying, "The kingdoms of this world are what? Become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever." Here we have the giving of the three angels' messages. What's the first angel's message? Why? His judgment against what? Iniquity. The closing up of the seven trumpets had come. God's judgment had come. Is come. If you want to read more, Revelation 14, 6 through 12. We have, as it were, symbolically, the three angels' messages given here, verses 15 through 17. We continue. "And the 24 elders which sat before God on their seats fell upon their faces and worshipped God, saying, We give thee thanks, O Lord God Almighty, which art and which wast and which art to come, because thou hast taken to thee thy great power and hast reigned. And the nations were angry," says verse 18, which began in the year 1848. From 1848, there has been almost incessant war in Europe and in America. From the year 1848, the nations are angry. And the result of these angry nations is given us in Revelation 16, verses 12 through 14. And chapter 17, verses 12 through 14. And if you're interested, please go look those up, if you want to understand the nature of what these angry nations culminates in. Read those verses. But now I want to turn our attention to verse 19, because we've been long. I want to close up. In verse 19, perhaps the most important verse in this whole study of the seven trumpets comes to view. It says, "And the temple of God was opened in heaven, and there were seen in his temple the ark of his testament. And there were lightnings and voices and thunderings and an earthquake and great hail. It says the temple of God in heaven was where? What? We see that phrase used one other time in the book of Revelation. Chapter 15, verses 5 and 6. What do those verses say? What's happening in chapter 15? There are seven angels that come out with seven vials full of the wrath of God. And the temple in heaven is opened, and these angels proceed out of that temple to pour out their plagues. Verse 19 tells us that the plagues fall. Historically, we're between verses 18 and 19. The nations are angry. They've been angry for a long time. And when you understand what that will culminate in, you will see just how close we are to the end. The very next thing that happens are the angels proceeding out. Michael stands up.
Yes.
And if you want to understand more of this, read Daniel 11, verses 44 to 45. Because the man of the east is not dead. His demise is the key that helps us understand when verse 19 happens. Because it's at that time that Michael stands up. Don't forget it.
Amen.
All of you who want to understand the time in which you live, read that chapter like you've never read it before, like your life depends on it, because it does.
My voice is bad. Can you repeat it?
Yes.
I have a dyslexic. Can you repeat the numbers again?
The chapter?
Yes.
Daniel chapter 11?
Mm-hmm.
And specifically verses 44 and 45. Those verses give us the key to know when Michael stands up and the plagues begin to be poured out. And so I want to leave you with this thought. 2 Peter 3, 11 to 12. Beloved, seeing then that all these things shall be destroyed, what manner of persons ought ye to be in all holy conversation and godliness, looking for and hasting? Doing what? That means we have a part to play. God is waiting for people ready to be sealed, fit to be sealed. Knowing that these things are coming, and they're coming in our day, what kind of people, holy people, ought we to be? God help us.
Amen.
Unto the coming of the day of God, wherein the heavens being on fire shall be dissolved, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. My hope and prayer is that that day will find you in Christ, and that it will find me in Christ. For I want to say when Christ comes, Alleluia. Amen. This is our God.
Yes.
And we have waited for Him.
Amen.
And if that's your prayer, I thank you for bearing with me. And I want you to kneel with me in a word of prayer as we close. Gracious Father in heaven, blessed art Thou. Holy art Thou. I bless Thee and thank Thee, Father, that Thou hast given us these words, that Thou hast seen fit not to do anything, but that Thou shouldst reveal these things through Thy servants, the prophets. And I am thankful, Father, that those servants were faithful to record these things for us, that we might know those things that pertain to our salvation, that we may understand the importance of the time in which we live. Help us, Father, to live as in the time of Thy coming, to know that it is near, that we might hear the jingling of the bells of our High Priest in heaven, that we might know His place, not simply His location, but we might know where He is every moment. Let us fasten our eyes upon Him and turn our hearts to Him with all of our heart. Let us relinquish any and every sin in our hearts. I pray, Father, help us. Help Thou our unbelief. Help us to be strong in faith. and strong in deeds. Help us to fulfill the prayer of Christ, that we might be one, that the world might know that thou art God. For this is my prayer, and I ask it in the blessed name of thy Son, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen.